What would your reaction be if I told you that the World Trade Center Twin Towers were a structural success story? Most people would be aghast. But think about it for a moment. Why do we have building codes? It's not to save the building. It's to save the people on the inside. And one aspect of building codes is that should the building ever be struck with a disaster, it needs to give people on the inside enough time to get out. On an average business day, the Twin Towers might have over 50,000 people on the inside, with another 140,000 moving through the complex, usually as part of their commute. On September 11th, 2001, the buildings were attacked, and over 2,600 people on the inside were killed. This includes 400 first responders who went into the buildings after the planes hit. Analysis shows that if you were above where the jets hit, you had a 99% chance of perishing. But if you were below where the jets hit, you had a 99% chance of getting out and surviving. After the buildings were maliciously targeted with jets so large, they did not exist when the buildings were being designed. 767s full of fuel and going at top speed, the Twin Towers stayed up long enough to allow over 50,000 people to get out and get to safety. In the light of such tragedy, that might be considered a success. The World Trade Center began as a way to develop Manhattan's lower tip, which had lost its luster in the 1940s and 50s as corporations began to move to Midtown. With the funds and power of the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, a semi-governmental agency, eminent domain was used to purchase the land on the west side of Lower Manhattan, known as Radio Row. Like the vacuum tube, the world had moved on and left it behind. This put the development next to the old H&M Railroad, which was also purchased by the Port Authority and renamed PATH, Port Authority Trans-Hudson. Work was begun in 1966, and the second tower was completed in 1973. But back in 1962, the Port Authority engaged Minoru Yamasaki as the lead architect, working with Emery, Roth, and Sons. The structural engineers were Worthington, Skilling, Helly, and Jackson, with Leslie Robertson in the design lead. Yamasaki had had some success with other projects, but was not considered an architectural powerhouse. Some speculate that the PA did this in order to exert more control over the project. The original design called for two towers 80 stories tall, but because there was a need for more rental space, that increased to 110 stories each, taller than the Empire State Building. I once read an apocryphal story where someone supposedly asks Yamasaki, why two towers at 110 stories? Yamasaki joked, because one tower, 220 stories, would be out of human scale. For architects, that's pretty funny. Yamasaki assured the Twin Towers of unobstructed views of the region by setting them off from each other and gathering them and five other buildings around a large open square, suitable for pedestrians and for gatherings. This cut off local roads and created what's known in urban planning as a superblock. After 9/11, I heard a lot of people criticize the superblock without any real evidence. They seem to have forgotten that Central Park or St. Peter's Square are among the many successful superblocks around the world. Downtown New York needed a large assembly space. City Hall Park and Battery Park are very nice, but they have a lot of green. So they don't give you that urban sense of space you get in a lot of the great squares around the world. I liked it because it gave you a sense that you arrived at a place and not just a building. Plus, it was a great way to admire the Twin Towers from the bottom all the way up to the top. But because of inclement weather, World Trade Center provided for underground passages for pedestrians and commuters, and that became the primary mode for most people. Consequently, the plaza was, like a lot of urban landscapes, underutilized and windy. But if you consider Manhattan Island as a sort of American-sized Île de la Cité, then the World Trade Center Twin Towers and its square are akin to Notre Dame de Paris and its square, both giving their cities a space in which to experience the urban identity. The design of tall buildings like this presented many problems. Structurally, they used a framed tube system pioneered by Fazlurrahman Khan. It creates a central reinforced steel core where you have things like the elevator shafts, the stair shafts, and the mechanical systems, and a separate structural system for the outside. The system on the outside of the Twin Towers has a lot of vertical pieces, which meant the towers had windows about 16 inches wide. This was a problem for some. But the result was that each floor, about an acre in area, had a lot of column-free space between the core and the perimeter windows, allowing architects to freely design the interior spaces. The floor spans were framed with lightweight steel trusses, whose spray-on fire protection was blown off when the jets impacted. This proved to be a design flaw that contributed to the building's collapsing. Such an impact negating the fire protection was not considered when the buildings were originally designed. They solved the problem of how to get people up to those floors quickly by using a series of elevators, both express and local, not unlike the New York City subway system. Express elevators might take you to one of two sky lobbies, and from there, you would catch a local elevator to your floor. This allowed up to three elevators to share a single shaft. Another nice feature about the World Trade Center was the main entrance was accessible both from the plaza level and the underground level, which brought you into the same space, six stories high. This made you feel like you had just arrived at the world's tallest building. It was much more successful than the lobby in the soon-to-follow and taller Sears Tower. Unlike many architectural critics, I liked the World Trade Center, both for its mammoth New York size and its bold simplicity. I suspect people who don't design anything get to feel superior by always finding fault with something else. Those who can't do, criticize. After some trepidation, the World Trade Center and the Twin Towers became another symbol for New York. It was essential as a marker as you walked around Lower Manhattan. And before they built Battery Park City on the soil excavated for the World Trade Center, from Hoboken, you could see the towers reach from the harbor all the way up 110 stories tall. And many people eventually loved to be associated with the World Trade Center, whether you were mayor, a working girl, or one of the many ordinary tourists who come to New York City. People like Philippe Petit, George Willick, and King Kong in the 1976 remake, although that did not end well. I liked the World Trade Center as I had a client who leased the 55th floor of World Trade 1, and I simply liked going there. Like many people, I watched the second jet hit live on TV. It is poignant to consider that the World Trade Center expired before my World Trade Center ID badge expired. After 9/11, I was one of the few people who thought the Twin Towers should be rebuilt as they were. Face it, if terrorists had destroyed the Statue of Liberty, would we be arguing about what different thing to put in its place? No. But once again, people did things without asking me. Fortunately, the new World Trade Center features a very tall building, for a while known as the Freedom Tower, which stands 1,776 feet tall with the spire. And the building industry learned some lessons that would make the new tower more enduring than the previous. We learned that we have to design for more hostile things than weather and gravity. Among the innovations are a more fortified concrete core to the building, with stairs dedicated to firefighters, and redundant structural elements such as welding and bolts. The tower is set back from the street so that a truck bomb's force would be dissipated before it reached the concrete reinforced base. I heard mention of an exterior skin designed to slice up the airplane before its mass could do damage to the interior, but I have not seen confirmation of this being in the final design. The new One World Trade Center is a magnificent building designed by David Childs of SOM, Skidmore, Owens, and Merrill. I like the subtle twist the building creates with an exterior shaped by inverted triangles. It has proven to be an innovative form for a skyscraper without trying to get fancy or weird to attract attention to itself. Now, if they were to only build a second one. I'm Michael Molinelli, and this is Architecture CodeX.